How do you conceptualize democracy?
Well, I would say that, first of all, democracy is not an exact science. Democracy is not a science, is not what the Greeks used to call episteme. So it means that we can talk about democracy as the art of organizing a society. But what we call today a good governance, and democracy as a good governance, is actually the best way to organize a society. Now, how could we organize a society with the help of the people? And that's the question which was asked by the Greeks and later on by the Europeans, and in these days is asked practically all over the world. I think that we can say that if democracy is supposed to be has to be related with popular sovereignty and with the governance of the people, it means that the people have to be at the source of the laws and of the institution of the society and the organization of the society. So it means that, first of all, they need to have this passion, which we call in political science the democratic passion. They need to have this passion of organizing the society. They cannot be apathetic. I mean, they cannot have this apathy, and they cannot be completely inactive and passive. Passive population, passive people, inactive people, citizens cannot make a democracy. So you have to have a full participation to have a democracy. Secondly, I think that once you have this passion, a democratic passion, you need to know how to organize it and in regard with which principles, actually, which ideas, which concepts you're organizing it. Now, I think one of the most important things in democracy which distinguishes it from aristocracy, from monarchy, from totalitarian regimes, is that the source of this principle is always inside the society itself. It's very transparent, it's very accountable, is questionable, and it has nothing to do with a principle like God or nature or, let's say, laws of history which find themselves outside the action of the people. So I would say that the democracy is the outcome of the action of a people, of a population, of citizens, of a city, let's say like the Greek city-states, or later on in American democracy, or French democracy, or we can see it today even in the Muslim world, some parts of the Muslim world, that it's the action of this population, but in regard with principles which are accountable, questionable, and somehow, I would say, even permeable.
Could you elaborate on the contributions Iranian thinkers have made to democratic theory, if any?
I think that the work of democracy has been there in the Iranian, contemporary Iranian history for the past 100 years, since the Constitutional Revolution of 1906. The first efforts from the Iranian intellectuals or from Iranian politicians or from the Iranian population goes back to the end of the 19th century with the encounters with the West, with Western ideas, with the development of the idea of law, lawmaking, constitution, and how to put end to autocracies and authoritarian regimes. So the result of all that was actually the first important revolution in the Middle East and in the Muslim world, which was the Iranian Constitutional Revolution of 1906 up to 1911. And I think that these are the first efforts, intellectual and political efforts, to somehow discuss and debate the problem of democracy in a country like Iran. From that day on, actually, the Iranian public sphere has been somehow an arena of quarrels, debates, and struggles, civic struggles, around the concept of democracy. Now, we have had the women's rights movements, we have had intellectual movements, we have had movements of nationalization and nationalism with Mossadegh, we have had struggles against the first Pahlavi regime and second Pahlavi regime, and after that the revolution of 1979, 78, 79, And after that, we had the Iranian theocracy up to now, after 32 years of Iranian theocracy. But I think that once this idea was already there in on the educational level, intellectual level, political level, but also at the level of political experience in the Iranian civil society, we had what we can call these sociological actors and political actors of democratization in Iran, in Iranian history. And there has been an evolution and development, a very transparent one, I would say, a very precise one, a very clear one, of these actors. These actors have changed according to different generations and in relation with their times. And nowadays, the democratic actors in Iranian society are mainly women and young, and the youth, actually, the youngsters. There was a time where they were mostly intellectuals and older generation of intellectuals and older generation of politicians, and somehow some political parties or people who were engaged actually at the ethnic level or religious level in this process of democratization. But today I think that we can say that the forerunners of democratization in Iranian society are mainly the Iranian youngsters who are very well educated, they know about democracy, they want to ask about democracy, and these are very many classes, I would say, they come from different backgrounds, and they are not only from the Iranian middle class as usually we say it, they come also from traditional middle classes, but also women who have been fighting for their rights for over 100 years.
Brilliant. Now, are there any distinct styles or types of democracy or democratic institutions that have come out of Iran?
There have been many experiences of democratization in Iran. I have to say that actually the forerunners of this democratization have been either on the liberal side, and they had a look on the classical liberalism as we know it in Europe, or they have been on the left, and they were mainly socialists or those who, without being very much under the influence of the Soviet Union and Soviet Marxism, they were those who wanted to bring social justice and social changes in regard with their readings on the left. So I think that we can distinguish between two main currents in Iranian political history in regard with democracy and democratization. On the one hand, we have all those intellectuals and later on statesmen or let's say politicians who are very much impressed by the readings of John Stuart Mill or later or Tocqueville or Montesquieu, or they believe in the separation of powers, or they their view of a state is a much more of a liberal state. But this was never found its true foundation, I would say, or institution, political institution in Iran. And on the other hand, there have been efforts, both intellectual and politically, at the level of socialist thinkers, the thinkers on the left, who also tried through their readings, but also through the influences they got from Europe, Marxism in Europe, and socialist currents in Europe. They, for them, democratization was less of a liberal reading of democracy and more of a leftist democracy. Now, in between these two secular trends, you have a religious trend which had its own evolution, starting from ultra-conservatism during the Constitutional Revolution of 1906 and opposing somehow itself as ultra-conservatives to this Constitutional Revolution, because they were already thinking of creating a theocracy back in 1906, more than 100 years ago. So you had this evolution from that time up to Ayatollah Khomeini and the foundation of the Islamic Republic in Iran. But in between the lines, you have had thinkers and also political trends and currents which believed in reforming Islam in having a more liberal reading of Islam, and it goes up until today. I mean, still you have a lot of reformists inside the Iranian regime and outside the Iranian regime who believe nowadays in democratization, in some kind of Islamic liberalism, and their readings of Islam is less a theological or theologically oriented, I would say, or theocratic Islam. It's not a fundamentalist Islam. It's an Islam which is very open-minded, and it's an Islam which is more in accord with the ideas, democratic ideas and liberal ideas as we know them in Europe.
Could you provide some information on how the citizenry is conceived in Iran?
Well, what you call citizenry is not exactly the same as we know it in Europe or in the West, or as we described it in ancient Greece when we were talking about democracy. I think that an Iranian citizen is somehow a citizen as he or she is described in the Iranian constitution. But we have to understand that the Iranian constitution is a mixed constitution which declares itself as a republican constitution but also as a theocratic. So necessarily you are not only a citizen of your city, which is a human city, you're also a citizen of the Ummah, which is actually the community of the believers. When you're living in a religious society, you cannot be necessarily only a non-believer society by definition. I mean, you are certainly, as you are defined by the constitution, as you are defined by the laws, you are also responsible in regard to the religious laws. So, Iranian citizenry will be at two levels. Is one level is the citizenry which is described or formulated by the regime itself, by the lawmaking of the Iranian regime, by the Iranian constitution. And at that level, I would say we are all sons and daughters of God and of the Prophet and of course of Iranian Shiism. And at the second level, we can talk about an invented citizenry, which is the work of the civil society and the work of actually the product of this democratic process, and is how people describe themselves, how the Iranian youngsters, Iranian women, Iranian intellectuals, they try to describe themselves. And I call that a republican gesture actually in Iranian arena, because this is where you can talk about the res publica. And you can talk about people actually describing themselves as not only in relation with the divine sovereignty, but also in relation with the popular sovereignty, and talking about their potentialities, capacities as citizens or members of a civil society which wants to reform and change a society. And we go back to this idea of self-organization of the society and democracy as a self-institution. This is where people describe themselves intellectually but also politically when they are in the public sphere as activists or as people who can change things, but they change it in regard to popular sovereignty and in regard to principles which they have in their own grasp, and it's not somewhere in history or in the metaphysics, which is outside, or in religious laws, which is outside their grasp.